So good morning, students. So today we are morning, going sir. To discuss.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
A very good morning. So today we are going to discuss on the nutrient cycle and their importance in case of agriculture or aquaculture production. So without a delay, we are just going to check our slides. So I am just going to share these slides to all of you. So probably the slide might have coming on your mobile screen. Okay. So is it visible to all of you? Okay. So our topic is nutrient cycles. So what nutrient cycle is? So a nutrient cycle, or it may be also called as ecologically recycling, is the movement and exchange of organic and inorganic matter back into the production of matter. So energy flow is a unidirectional, as you might have knowing this fact, and these are non-cyclic pathway. But the movement of mineral nutrients is cyclic, which include carbon cycle, sulfur cycle, nitrogen cycle, then phosphorus cycle, water cycle, oxygen cycle, and so on. So we just look into the introductory part of nutrient cycle. So nutrient cycle is an essential process in an ecosystem. And in the nutrient cycle, the uses of the nutrients in the environment, their movement and the process, their recycling are described. Important nutrients that we must know, that they include carbon, oxygen, hydrogen, phosphorus, nitrogen, which are required to be recycled for the existence of organisms, for the sustenance for life. They also involve for the biological, geological, and different biochemical process. And so why these nutrient circuits are also known as biogeochemical cycles together. They are known as biogeochemical cycles. So with this diagram, we can see the nutrient cycle. So how these nutrient cycle makes us life, make a complete food web alive, make a complete food chain in a living condition and dependent on each other. So you just see that if water and air, when they penetrate into soil, then what happens? The mineral and other nutrient released into soil. Okay, water and air penetrate to soil, minerals and other nutrients, or minerals like nitrogen, that is precipitated by this rainfall. Then other minerals that is trapped within that raindrops is precipitated by this rain and absorbed by the soil. Then this soil contains some minerals, is absorbed by this plant. This plant use all these minerals as a nutrient purpose for their growth. Then after the growth of this plant, the other food chain dependent on this plant, like herbivores, they sustain their life. When these herbivores or the old leaves when fallen down on the earth, or the excreta of the herbivores that mix with the soil. Again, these add minerals into the soil after the decomposing of this complex organic matters. Once decomposition takes place, again these mineral and other nutrients are released by soil, and with the growth of the roots, thus rocks can be broken down, and it form with a weathering of soil, it form a simpler form of soil like sand, silt and clay. So you have seen that how earth is formed due to the degrading and decomposition process of microbes. Then once these microbes, and how these microbes play a major role in the decomposition and degradation of the complex organic materials, break down into mineral or nutrient that is essential for the growth of plants and for the growth of animals, which are dependent on the growth of plant. So primary producer and the secondary, the consumer. So now we will discuss the most important cycle of the atmosphere is nitrogen cycle. As we know that nitrogen in this atmosphere contains how much percentage of nitrogen present in the air? It is the 79% nitrogen within the atmosphere, especially in troposphere. I hope that all of you are knowing that what is troposphere. Then how this nitrogen is absorbed? Plant absorb generally ammonical form, that is NH4, or in nitrate form, that is NO3. So what happened? First, these ammonia, what happens? You just see the nitrogen in atmosphere, it is fixed by bacteria. The bacteria that live in the plant roots, that live in the soil. So they fix this nitrogen from the atmosphere, and when this nitrogen fixation occurs, then the process of, then you see, then it forms the ammonia. Once ammonium ion is formed, it is converted into nitrite is NO2, and once nitrite is formed, it is again transformed into nitrates by the another group of bacteria. And one nitrate is formed, either these ammonium ions are used by plants, or these nitrates are used by plants. As you can see the flow chart or schematic diagram, then these plants absorb these nitrates, and the animal dependence on this plant take this plant, and again the excreta or fecal materials, they release the nitrogen containing organic compounds. This is decomposed by different microbiota present in the soil and in the atmosphere, and ammonium ion is released. So you can see here that the question is being asked that what is ammonification? Ammonification is the fixation of ammonia from the nitrogen containing organic compounds. The process in which ammonia is being formed by the fixation of nitrogen containing organic compounds. Okay, whether it is not nitrogen in atmosphere or through nitrogen containing organic compounds, this process is called ammonification. The conversion of ammonium ion into nitrite is called the nitrification process. Again, when the nitrite conversion of nitrites to nitrates occur due to the decomposition of nitrifying bacteria, then these nitrates are again released or denitrified by certain groups of bacteria, which is called denitrification. The process of the conversion of nitrates to atmospheric nitrogen or the conversion of nitrates to nitrogen is called the denitrification process. What is nitrification? Nitrification is the conversion of ammonia into nitrate, is the nitrification process. What is ammonification? The conversion of nitrogen containing organic compounds to ammonium is called ammonification. Okay, so all this process is named according to conversion of different nitrogen derived parts. So you can check here how this nitrogen cycle is being transformed by different groups of bacteria. So you just see that once ammonia is released in case of even in aquaculture, then bacterial decomposition, yani oxidation of NH3 takes place. Once oxidation takes place, then either it will convert into the once ammonia is formed, the oxidation takes place, then the nitrosomonas bacteria, it converts into nitrite ions. Then these nitrite ions are further converted by the group of bacteria through the oxidation of the nitrite ion into nitrate, and the bacteria responsible for this process is the nitrobacter. Once the nitrate is converted by this nitrite ion, it can be act as a fertilizer or uptake for the plant, uptake as a plant protein. Okay, so this nitrate is easily absorbed by the plant tissues. Plant convert these nitrates for their essential elements like carbohydrate, protein and all. Once plant is dead, the organic matter is formed, or either if the plant is consumed by animal, then the waste matter created by this animal or due to death of this animal protein, again the dead organic matter, this is the complex organic compound, it is decomposed, or oxidation of this organic material takes place, again this is further converted into ammonia and ammonical ions, and further this cycle carries on and it adds to the productivity for the soil or the water in which we culture aquatic animals or plants. So this was given in the short. So it in your end term questions, in your end term exam, the question might be asked, please neatly draw a nitrogen cycle, or briefly explain about the nitrogen cycle. Then you have to draw a neat diagram of this nitrogen cycle, as well as if you even write a simple process like ammonification, nitrification, denitrification, it will give a good impact to your examiner. So next is the carbon cycle. So it contains proteins, carbohydrates and organic molecules. So we know that carbon is present in all those proteins or organic, any organic materials contains carbon, isn't it? So there may be protein, carbohydrate, or any other organic molecules. This is being fixed by plants from the atmosphere, as we know. So how this carbon cycle is very simple and common. So once the combustion of fossil fuel occurs, it goes to the atmosphere. Once the carbon is present in atmosphere due to photosynthesis, plant fix this carbon, and feeding of this plant, consumer take these organic carbon and assimilate it. After the respiration, again they release CO2 into the atmosphere, or due to the death and decay, these carbon is released by the degradation or decomposition of this complex organic matters as a carbon and released to the atmosphere. So it is very simple phenomena, as you can check. Then next is oxygen cycle. From your elementary education till now, you have studied a lot about oxygen cycle. So it is an essential element for all the biological organisms. So how oxygen cycles is carried on? So oxygen is released by the plant tissues or any photosynthetic organisms. So how they do? They fix, they fix carbon and release oxygen. Then due to this complex photosynthetic process, they release oxygen. This oxygen is released into the atmosphere, that is consumed by the consumers or by other animals. Then these animals and sometimes plants also breathe oxygen. Then these carbon dioxide again released by these animals, it is being used by this plant. So this is overall the oxygen, and you can say how this mutual relationship is benefiting to all the producers and the consumers, the photosynthesizers and the respirators. Then next we are coming on to the phosphorus cycle. So as we know, the phosphorus is the essential element and the building block component of a biological molecule such as RNA and DNA. Even though you are knowing that DNA, what is the full form of DNA? Deoxyribonucleic acid. RNA is ribonucleic acid. So in that, you might know that there is a pentose sugar, isn't it? Phosphate molecules. Even RNA, DNA, phospholipids. Even in phospholipids, phosphorus groups is there. You can find there adenotriphosphate. It is the energy that is being expensed or during the process of metabolism. And they generally use pentose sugar, isn't it? PO4. So how this phosphorus cycle takes place? So if we see the phosphorus cycle, we can see that these phosphorus comes from where? From the weathering of rock. From the weathering of rock, and weathering of rock occurs again how? After the degradation and decomposition of the small microbes or microbiota inhibiting at particular site. Then these weathering of rocks occurs maybe natural, or it may be due to anthropogenic activities, isn't it? So these weathering of rocks, when we are talking about the natural phenomena, it might be due to microbes or any other volcanic activities or any natural disaster, flood or whatever. So these weathering of rocks add phosphates in soil. These phosphates assimilated by plant cells. Okay. Once these phosphates are assimilated by these plant cells, and weathering of rocks, when it adds phosphates in soil, after the precipitation of rain, these phosphates can drain into the pond, isn't it? So when these phosphates are assimilated in terrestrial, if we are saying about the terrestrial region, it is assimilated by plant cells, or in case of aquatic ecosystem, it is used by the planktons. Then again, when this is assimilated by these plant tissues, then other organisms which depends on these plants, they eat on their leaves, they release urine and fecal materials. Again, along with the nitrogen, carbon, they also contain phosphorus, isn't it? So it adds phosphates in soil. Okay. So this was the cycle of phosphorus within a terrestrial area. But when we are discussing about the phosphorus cycle in aquatic ecosystem, when these when this phosphorus is used by this phytoplankton, these phytoplankton is consumed by several other organisms, then due to the geologic uplift movement of the rocks into terrestrial environments, these phosphates again converted into rocks, okay? And these rocks again can build a stones or a heaps of stones. So you see in upcoming slide, you just see the phosphorus cycle in a water, how it takes place. So river discharge, it adds soluble phosphates, it is used by phytoplankton, phytoplankton is consumed by zooplankton and animals. Then animals or dead or animals and plants, after they are dead and decay, they add organic residues of phosphates, and it occurs due to what? Due to the complex process of decomposition by these microorganisms that aid again soluble phosphates. Okay, so this is the overall the phosphorus cycle in the water. Then next is the sulfur cycle. Sulfur is the key constituent of certain amino acids like start codon, as we know, methionine and cysteine. That is the sulfur containing amino acids, isn't it? So why sulfur is also an essential constituent among the different biochemical groups? Then sulfur is abundant in some minerals and rocks and has significant presence in soil, water and atmosphere. So sulfur dioxide is a gas. It is emitted by different natural or anthropogenic activities. In case of natural phenomena, it is emitted by volcanic eruptions or released by coal-fired power plants due to anthropogenic activities or metal smelters. In the atmosphere, these sulfur dioxide becomes oxidized into the anion, negatively charged ion. Then sulfur dioxide becomes oxidized into sulfate, and which occurs as tiny particulates or in dissolved in suspended droplets of moisture. Then when they form sulfate, in this form the negative charge of sulfate must be balanced by positive charge of cations such as ammonium, calcium or hydrogen ion. Then hydrogen sulfide, when sulfate again converted into hydrogen sulfide, it is emitted naturally from volcanoes and deep sea vents, and it is also released from habitats where other organic sulfur compounds are being decomposed under anaerobic condition. So H2S formed in anaerobic condition. So the microorganism responsible for the formation of H2S must have a characteristics of anaerobic or anaerobes and form oxygen poor aquatic ecosystem where sulfate is being reduced to H2S. Yani if an aquatic ecosystem or bottom of aquatic ecosystem is becomes anaerobic, these sulfate molecules is converted into or reduced into hydrogen sulfide that becomes hazardous for the aquatic other aquatic organism. Okay, and that cannot be further used by the plant as a mineral nutrient, although it becomes toxic for many cultivable organisms. So we can check here even that how this overall process occurs. So sulfur reduction assimilating, you just see here, this is the sulfate. There are various sulfate is reduced into organic sulfur. Organic sulfur is reduced, further reduced by H2S by the microorganism. Ye sulfate bhi jo hai wo kya convert ho sakta hai direct H2S mein when anaerobic condition persist and it is converted by desulfovibrio. Then sulfur reduction dissimilating. Okay, so here reduction of sulfate into H2S takes place. Again, even SO3 form can reduced into H2S or sulfur. So all these forms can be reduced by particular microbes is called desulfovibrio. But in case of SO3, it is the Alteromonas, Clostridium, and desulfovibrio again. You check here. Then so how this H2S is converted into elemental sulfur? Then these elemental sulfur is again oxidized and becomes sulfate. Okay, then sulfate and sulfide, and these sulfide again reduced into H2S, or otherwise it is converted into organic sulfur, which is further reduced by as an H2S. So now these H2S can be oxidized by some anaerobic microorganisms like Chlorobium or Chromatium. Chlorobium is a vesicle found where? In Chlorobium vesicle found where? In green sulfur bacteria. Green sulfur bacteria. If you have remind that. Then Thiobacillus, Bagiatua, Thiothrix, these converts elemental sulfur into H2S. So here this was the little bit brief about the different biogeochemical cycles within an aquatic ecosystem and as well as in terrestrial ecosystem. So I hope that most of the most important nutrient cycles we have discussed. So now if you have any question regarding this, you can ask the question.